Just ahead on Primary Care, we took Primary Care on the road to speak with Dr. Lenore Coleman about the lack of African-American participation in clinical trials. Later, we head back to the studio and talk with epidemiologist Christine Joseph. We'll talk to her about the alarming rates of asthma among African-Americans and her latest research. Stay with us. Primary Care starts right now. Hi, I'm Dr. Lonnie Joe of Primary Care, and I'm here with Dr. Lenore Coleman from Healing Our Village in Atlanta, Georgia. Dr. Coleman, welcome to the show.
Hi, how are you? Thank you so much for letting me talk to you today.
Absolutely, my pleasure. Listen, you're a pharmacist. You've been on this battlefield for a long time in terms of helping us as physicians understand disease states, in particularly diabetes, and also understand the approach that should be taken and the medications that should be used. How did you get started in this?
Well, actually, back in 1996, my pastor died a sudden death in the pulpit. And it was actually on my birthday, September the 6th of 96. And so I decided to, at that point, dedicate the rest of my career to trying to focus on health disparities and focus on populations of color so that they would not die before their time.
And basically, you've been helping us for years in terms of the treatment and the research aspect of diabetes. Tell us about clinical trials. And, you know, our population always wants to refer back to the Tuskegee study and some of the lesser known studies also that happened years ago and had a negative effect on the African-American community. Tell us about clinical trials and the importance of clinical trials.
Yeah, the reason that we, Healing Our Village, actually got involved in clinical trials, it's been about 10 years now, is because we noticed that in most of the pharmaceutical studies and some of the biotech studies, there's very few minority populations that are part of that trial. The problem with that is that if you don't have a representative number of patients in the study, then the results basically can't be then broadly accepted and used. So we decided that it'd be important for us to find out, you know, because of Tuskegee and because of the trust issues with that particular United Public Health Services study that was done, ways that we could assure African Americans that it's safe now, that there are many, many safeguards in place that weren't in place before, and that there's many, many benefits for them to participate in clinical research, especially in places like Michigan, for instance. There are many people here that don't have health insurance, that don't have physicians. Clinical research is a way that they can actually come in and get free study-related care. They can get medications. They're able to get their meters and their blood glucose strips for free. So there's lots of reasons to participate in this kind of research.
But in practice, we continue to struggle with patients who are highly suspicious. Tell me about the role of the physician, the comfort level that we should be trying to reach with those patients in convincing them that you're really a good candidate for this clinical trial.
Yeah, so our model at HOV Clinical Research is actually to work with primary care providers, mostly internal medicine, family practice. We work with endocrinologists, nephrologists, and what we do is we bring those physicians into the studies. They actually become the researchers, so they are able to reach out to their patients. We know that African-American patients and populations of color see doctors that look like them. We know that there is an importance of trust if your physician relatively is the same culture that you are. And so because of that, we know that if you were to reach out to your patients and tell them about a particular research study that you were participating in as their physician, they will be more inclined to go into that study than if someone from an academic research institution or someone that they don't know approaches them to be in the study. Even when we talk to patients about being in the study, what they all say to us is, well, sounds good, but let me check with my physician first.
Nora, 2-3 years ago, diabetes was classified as a cardiovascular disease. What are we doing wrong? We do seem to be making some progress, but at the same time, in the African American community, we still seem to be treading water in terms of the progress that we need to make in treatment of these patients. The renal dialysis is going through the roof, the heart attacks, we're not moving the needle on that.
And the root cause of a lot of these endpoints is diabetes.
Right, right. Well, first of all, there's a lot of folks that don't even know they have diabetes. So we know that there's 29 million people that...
Yeah, most people who have it don't know it.
A lot of people who have it right. don't know it. So that's the first thing. So when you go into your health fairs or to your doctor, you need to ask them what your blood sugar is. And if it's greater than 100, then you're actually in the pre-diabetes stage. It needs to be less than 100. And if you get up to 126 or higher, then you potentially could have diabetes. The reason why we're seeing so much more diabetes than we have ever seen is because of obesity. So obesity and diabetes go hand in hand. And we know that in the African American community, they are probably the most obese folks actually in the world. So one of the reasons that we see so much diabetes is that we have so much body mass that the little pancreas that puts out the insulin just can't keep up with the volume, the mass that it's struggling to try to keep. But the other issue is that there's a lot of denial. So I do a lot of health fairs, and I tell patients blood sugars are high, and I say, well, you know, your blood sugar's high today. Did anybody ever tell you you had diabetes? And they'll say, oh, yeah, about 2 or 3 years ago, my doctor told me I had diabetes, but I didn't claim that, or I'm not believing that, all right? Or, yeah, but I've just been trying to just take care of it with food and exercise. And I say, well, so how many times a week do you exercise? They say, well, I don't. So there's so much denial going on in terms of diabetes. And then for those that have diabetes and accept the diagnosis, they don't want to take their medications. I'm a pharmacist by training, a certified diabetes educator. And what we find is that even though the doctor, prescribes the medication, spends the time to tell them how to use it, when they go home, they don't use it as you tell them to use it. Sometimes they don't even get the prescription filled at the pharmacy. Once you hand it to them, they go to the pharmacy. The pharmacy will say, well, it's a $20 copay, it's a $50 copay, and they don't have the money even for the copay. So therefore, they don't get the prescription medication.
So diabetes in an African-American female may be a little overweight, may have some hypertension. That's heart disease.
And you know, the reason that I am for so focused right now on hypertension and high blood pressure is because that hand in hand with diabetes is really what's causing the kidney disease. If you go to any dialysis center in this country and look and see who's in there, it is people, African Americans, and it's mainly because of the hypertension. We are not taking the medications as prescribed. Usually for you to control blood pressure in an African American woman or man, they need to be on 2, potentially 3 medications. And if they're not taking those medications routinely, then their blood pressure goes up. Again, lifestyle is real important for high blood pressure control. And even if you lose just 5% of your body weight, you can really make a big, huge difference in your blood pressure. And then the other thing for people of color, I think, minority populations, African Americans specifically, is the stress and strain that they have in their daily life. If you're trying to figure out how you're gonna pay rent, if you don't have grocery stores in your area, if it's a high crime area, if you're not able to go to your local park because you don't feel it's safe, all of these, what we call social determinants of health, all of those are what makes it so difficult for us to treat the chronic diseases like diabetes and high blood pressure.
So, the challenges are real. They're very large. One of the other challenges that we face is the use of generic medications. Now, unfortunately, all generics are not created equal.
Right.
On a prescribing end, we don't know what patients get when they leave the drugstore. We're talking about trying to keep costs down, trying to get compliance in line, and we're not sure what patients are getting. Will you speak to this generic issue in terms of prescribing that we have in this country?
Yeah. Okay, so this is interesting from a pharmacist standpoint. When I actually had my own pharmacy that we managed, there's actually a book. And this is called the Orange Book.
Orange Book.
And that book tells you which generics have been tested
right.
and are very equivalent
right.
to the brand name product.
Right.
What I see happening, especially with large chains, is that they don't know where they're getting their generics from, what generic house is producing it. So I know for a fact that some of the medications that are out there in the marketplace are not the same as the brand name medication. And I know this because I have patients who are taking it as prescribed and they're not getting better.
Absolutely. In this community, we are probably above 22 different sources of metformin. Still
yes.
in freshman medical school, we're teaching first line after diet and exercise and treating patients who have diabetes.
Right.
But we can't be sure what they're getting.
No.
And we're not moving the needle on the numbers, right? The numbers, you just gave numbers on where people should be. The numbers tell the story. So, patients go away and say, oh, it's not that bad. It's only 160.
Right.
Is there a difference between 160 and 300?
Yeah, exactly.
So if we can't talk about compliance, treat to target, treat to go, we're not really helping these patients. Plus, we may be using a substandard product that we have no control over.
Yeah. So for the physician audience that you have out there, if you see a patient and they're telling you, doc, I'm taking it every day, you know, don't just assume that they're just, you know, telling you a tale, that they're not doing it. There may be actually a problem with the generic that they're receiving. Metformin is very interesting. I know for a fact that some of the generics out there cause a lot more diarrhea than others, and that's one of the ways that I can tell that that generic's not such a good generic.
Or because Mrs. Jones comes in and says, I see it in my stool every other day.
Yeah, exactly, right. Exactly. The tablet's not even dissolving.
Right.
So you got to make sure, and the way that you do that as a physician is work with your local pharmacy. I really like to support independent pharmacists as much as we can because you can get a relationship with them. They try a little harder because they're trying to survive in this day and age of retail pharmacy. And so if you could get a relationship with some of your independents out here, it really would serve you well because then you could tell them that you want them to buy this particular generic.
You and the great Dr. James Gavin have partnered for the last several years, doing a marvelous job at Healing Our Village. How did this collaboration come about? Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, when I was with Bayer Pharmaceuticals, I actually met Dr. Gavin, and he was one of the speakers for that pharmaceutical company. And I was brand new, and he sort of took me under his wing and helped me sort of understand the ropes of working in the pharmaceutical industry. And then when my pastor died, at that point in time, I went to him and said, listen, I'm about to start a business called Healing Our Village, and we're going to focus on medication management. We're going to focus on advocacy, outreach. We're going to try to really get African-American, Latino populations in better control. Will you come over and be my chief medical officer and CEO? And of course, you know, his heart has always been in disparities. And then when we did the clinical trials piece about 10 years ago, he is, as you know, on many of the boards of these various pharmaceutical companies. He also does a lot of lecturing for them. So that sort of helped us be able to knock down some of those barriers. Because I think that we need to do a much better job at getting minorities enrolled in these clinical research trials. And Healing Our Village is one of the few companies out here that has a better mousetrap to be able to get those patients to participate.
Well, you're certainly doing a wonderful job. We look forward to all kinds of collaborations in the future. And thank you for joining us on the show today. We've been talking with Dr. Lenore Coleman from Healing Our Village in Atlanta, Georgia. Thank you.
Appreciate it.
I'm Bea Smith, and I suffer from Alzheimer's disease. Brain disease affects millions. Unfortunately, minorities are underrepresented in research, so we may not be getting the best possible care. The Brain Health Registry collects vital information online for free. So please tell your story. I'm telling mine. Help find cures faster by visiting brainhealthregistry.org.
Asthma is a chronic disease state that inflames the air passages and causes narrowing. It affects over 4 million African Americans, and for years it was thought to be more prevalent among black youth living in urban environments than among those living in rural areas. But findings from a study conducted by researchers at Henry Ford Hospital and the Medical College of Georgia suggest otherwise. One of the lead investigators on this study is my next guest. Dr. Christine Joseph is senior epidemiologist and director of the Health Disparities Research Collaboration at the Henry Ford Health System. Her research focuses on asthma and racial and ethnic health disparities. Dr. Joseph, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
Good. This study sort of dispels some myths that we've been working with in asthma treatment and research for a long time. Will you elaborate on what the actual findings showed?
Well, that study was actually one of a series of studies that we've been doing to evaluate an asthma management program that is geared towards urban youth. It's called Puff City. And in the study that we did in Georgia, what we found was that African Americans in Detroit had a higher prevalence of asthma than the youth in Georgia. But when we looked at just the African Americans in Georgia, we found that the prevalence of asthma was pretty much the same. So what that leads us to believe is that it's not just living in an urban area per se that is a risk factor for asthma. It looks like being black is a risk factor for asthma, regardless of where you reside.
Like so many other disease states that
like
we deal with.
Like so many other chronic diseases.
Before we go any further, why don't you tell us, for our audience, what an epidemiologist is and what do they do?
So an epidemiologist is someone that studies disease patterns and trends. It comes from the word epidemic. When we think of an epidemic, we think of a disease that has a higher rate than what you might normally expect. A lot of times we think about infectious diseases when we think about an epidemic or food poisoning, but epidemiologists also study chronic diseases and study those diseases when the prevalence or rate of disease tends to be higher in one population than another. Epidemiologists also identify risk factors for disease, and the main factor in epidemiology is that we study disease in populations as opposed to studying disease in individuals.
And asthma, as a disease state, has a higher prevalence amongst African Americans, especially some of the younger age groups. What are some of the risk factors that contribute to this prevalence?
So when you talk about asthma and the contributing factors to asthma, it's important to think about what causes the disease to develop, as well as once you have the disease, what factors contribute to having an asthma attack. In terms of the factors that cause asthma to develop, there seem to be many, but researchers are finding that events that occur in that first year of life are really important. Probably the main factor contributing to the development of asthma is heredity. If you have parents that have asthma, you're more likely to have asthma. But events occurring in that first year of life are very important because it determines how well your immune system is going to develop. There's a hypothesis called the hygiene hypothesis that says we're too clean now and that our children are not having the exposures and the childhood infections that they usually have. Those infections and those exposures kind of help to kickstart the immune system. And when that immune system is developing as it should, there's a lower likelihood that someone is going to develop asthma. Now, once a person has been diagnosed with asthma, there are many things that can cause an asthma attack. Probably one of the main risk factors for an asthma attack would be exposure to tobacco smoke. But people who have asthma, about 60 to 70% of them are also going to be allergic to something. And so persons that come in contact with what they're allergic to are going to be at risk of an asthma attack. So one of the first things that we tell patients when about managing their asthma is to identify those triggers, those things that will cause an asthma attack. So for some people, it's grass or pollen. For others, it can be strong smells. It's important that persons with asthma identify what their personal triggers are.
We know that in young females, asthma can be a different disease. There are some wicked forms of asthma that I've seen in young females, particularly African Americans. Is there a gender component?
So the gender component is really quite interesting. In infancy and childhood, actually boys are more likely to have asthma. And we start to see that change over right around adolescence. And then by middle age, we do see that women are more likely to have asthma and they're more likely to use the emergency department and be hospitalized for asthma. I think researchers don't know the reason for that yet.
Do we have a public health crisis on our hands with this disease? Emergency room visits 300% higher for African Americans. Hospitalizations 500% higher for African Americans. So much for length of stay and utilizing the insurance industry's money properly in a disease state like this. It gets blown out of proportion. Would you classify this as a public health crisis at this point?
I really think it is a crisis, and I think it's been a crisis for some time. We've seen these kinds of grave disparities in asthma morbidity and mortality for several decades now, and we have not been able to appropriately address these disparities. it's really going to take more effort on our part to narrow those disparities and make sure that people with asthma are getting the care that they need.
Thank you, Dr. Joseph. Stay with us. We'll be back for more of Primary Care. Welcome back to Primary Care. We're here with Dr. Christine Joseph, Senior Epidemiologist and Director of the Health Disparities Research Collaborative at the Henry Ford Health System. Dr. Joseph, what is the cost of asthma to our society? We see what we call frequent flyers in the emergency room with this disease all the time. Everybody knows each other by name because, you know, by the end of the month, they've been there four, five, six times. What is the overall cost, the cost burden for this disease state to our society?
Well, the costs of asthma are really quite high. We spend $56 billion a year on asthma indirect healthcare costs. About $6 billion of that is indirect costs. And by indirect costs, I mean the cost to society, the cost of lost school days, the cost of lost work and productivity. So asthma is really costly for this country.
Dr. Joseph, you're a researcher, you're a scientist. Tell us what's coming down the pike in terms of the disease state, and also comment on how we get more African Americans to participate in this whole world of research, and particularly clinical trials.
Well, I think having African Americans participate in research is really important. African Americans are more likely to bear the burden of diseases that are the leading causes of death in the United States: heart disease, cancer, kidney disease. We are disproportionately represented in those diseases, and so it's important that we participate in clinical trials that are seeking to alleviate the adverse outcomes from those diseases. I think that it's a two-way street. I think that investigators need to show themselves to be trustworthy. They need to communicate with patients about the importance of research and be very clear about the research that they are trying to conduct and how patients can play a role in that. I think that researchers need to realize that this takes time and resources on the part of the participant, and try to help participants with the ability to participate in their research, reimburse them for their time, provide transportation if that's necessary. I think, on the other hand, patients need to realize that the way that we make medical advances is not in a vacuum. We need patients' help in order to find answers to some of the problems that we're experiencing. So I'd like to see patients become a little more savvy about research. And I have seen this. Patients do know what a consent form is, and they do know that they should expect to be reimbursed for their time if they incur charges for being in a study. It's really important that both parties work together so that we can make advances and eliminate some of these health disparities.
I like to look at this as a remake of the patient-physician relationship, just in a different arena called research. I think it's something that we've done before. We don't have to reinvent the wheel to do this. We need to be more diligent about building that relationship. Here again, you're a researcher. Tell us about the PERC program over at Henry Ford. It's very interesting.
So PERC stands for Patient Engaged Research Center, and it is funding that Henry Ford Health System has received from the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality. The funding is going to help us build infrastructure for patient-centered outcomes research. This is a relatively new concept in research that encompasses the patient idea and the patient needs in all facets of research. So the idea is to involve the patient in research even from the very beginning, from determining what research questions we're going to address, all the way to how the research is going to be implemented and how the research results are going to be disseminated. I'm investigator in the PERC Center, and the project that we're working on is a project that deals with asthma and obesity. We find that many of our asthma patients also are at an unhealthy weight. And when they are at an unhealthy weight, we find that their asthma is more difficult to control. The project that we're putting together right now will glean information from patients about their asthma management and about their weight. And we're gathering information about their attitudes, about their feelings, about what's important to them in terms of managing their asthma and being at a healthy weight. We collect that information and we feed it into our electronic medical record in real time so that the physician, during the clinical encounter, has this information from the patient and can use it as a discussion guide. We hope that this is going to facilitate communication between the physician and the patient and motivate the patient to make healthy changes and develop a more healthy lifestyle. I should mention that on the other side of that, we're training physicians to ask the right questions of patients and to begin a dialogue with patients and to glean from patients what's important to them in terms of disease management.
It's good to hear you include the ongoing process of physician education, because sometimes we do forget that. This is exciting and looks like it holds a lot of promise for the treatment of asthma in the future. Thank you, Dr. Joseph. Dr. Christine Joseph has been our guest senior epidemiologist at the Henry Ford Healthcare System. Thank you for joining us on Primary Care.
It's been a pleasure.
Thank you for joining us. I'm Dr. Lonnie Joe, and we'll see you next time on Primary Care.